Hello friends, my name is Abhay Kumar and I am today going to talk about Sir Syed Ahmad Khan. Today is March 27 and the great Sir Syed Ahmad Khan died on the same day in 1898, that is almost 204 year back. Friends, the founder of Aligarh College, Aligarh Muslim University, and also the great reformer of Muslim society in South Asia. Sir Syed Ahmad Khan has been a very important figure in Indian history, and he has been interpreted in different way. For many people, he is great reformer, he is a great champion of educations, and he advocated for Western educations. And for many, I think Sir Syed Ahmad Khan is a founder of, or you could say the founding father of, the idea of Pakistan and separatism. Recently, some intellectuals from the lower caste background, which are known as Pasmanda intellectuals, they are also reading Sir Syed Ahmad Khan from caste perspective, and they are saying that Sir Syed Ahmad Khan was a supporter of Ashrafiya culture, that is upper caste culture, and he supported caste system. So his life is full of controversy, but nevertheless, he is really a big figure. He is a big figure. He wrote a lot. He wrote in English. He wrote in Urdu. He led a big movement, and he founded Aligarh Muslim University. That has produced intellectuals, scientists, historians, academics, shayar, Urdu writers, fiction writers in large number. So I am going to talk on this issue, Sir Syed Ahmad Khan, his legacy, why he is important, with my friend Soheb Niazi. Soheb Niazi has just completed his PhD from Freie University in Germany, Berlin, and his topic is related to the theme which we are going to take up. He wrote his PhD on the topic of production and contestation of social hierarchy among Muslims at Amroha Kasba in colonial India, and his time period was around 1870 to 1940. Before doing his PhD in Berlin, he did his MPhil at Jawaharlal Nehru University at the Department of Political Science, Center for Political Studies, and his theme was exactly on Sir Syed Ahmad Khan and his ideas of Tahzeeb culture. So first of all, Soheb, congratulations for completing your PhD.
Thank you.
I just asked that can I call you doctor? So he said that in Berlin, unless you get your PhD printed, you are not formally
published.
Doctor. So, yeah. So which title I can use right now?
The official title is Dr. Des, but you can call me Soheb.
Acha, Soheb. Yeah. Dr. Des.
Yeah, Dr. Des, okay. For dissertation.
Okay. Dr. Des. He's Dr. Des for me. He's my friend, Dr. Soheb. So, Soheb, now your PhD is complete. You have done your work. And now I'm asking if you have to recall the legacies, the ideas, the role, the contribution, criticism, controversy of Sir Syed Ahmad Khan, what would you like to say?
Thank you, Abhay. Of course, as you already pointed out in your introduction, someone like Sir Syed Ahmad is a very key figure to not just for Muslims, but also to understand the encounter of India and Hindustan with colonial modernity, especially in the era of 19th century. And with such key figures like Sir Syed, we need to understand that someone like him is a person who has written more than 6,000 pages of published works.
6,000 pages?
Yes. And besides, he has a number of speeches, besides including text and sort of also essays that were published in various journals published by the Mohammedan Anglo-Oriental College. So such a figure is almost, who has such a large oeuvre, is just like Jawaharlal Nehru or Gandhi or Ambedkar is as important. Having said that, such a historical figure is also has a lot of changes. Uske andar bahut si tabdiliyan hongi. And Sir Sayyed himself quotes somewhere where he says that if ideas do not change, there is almost, if they become stagnant, that is not what progress means. So of course there are several inconsistencies. Sir Sayyed spans the whole length of the 19th century from 1817 to 1898, and several key junctures sort of in the 19th century he becomes sort of gives an account. So while through Sir Sayyed, his life, his biography, his writings, one can have an understanding of not just his own worldview but also of 19th century India, and especially North India, where he came from. So, yes.
I would ask you the questions related to how historians have looked at. Could you talk about the historiography on the personality of Sir Sayyed Ahmad Khan? How many broad camps would be who have looked at Sir Sayyed Ahmad Khan? I know I have just mentioned that social reformers, maybe for somebody his idea of the modern Pakistan, or for many, for the nationalists, he would be the man who propagated the idea of separatism. So what are the broad historiography? Some important historical work if you want to mention.
Yes, definitely. I mean, he's an extremely important figure for historians. And as you mentioned in your introduction, he's also labeled as all kinds of sort of contradictory labels. Mm. So while of course he's the founder of Aligarh Muslim University, which is the most common sort of association with Sir Sayyed, but also many called him the first modern thinker. So the inaugurator of first Muslim modern thinker among Muslims, who talked of the Jadid and the new. But and then for instance we see that there are scholars who also refer to him as a liberal, someone like C.A. Bailey, who's a big historian, considered him as one of the liberals among Nehru and others. At the same time, we have this trend of people who also call him as the one who started separatism. Not that he did it himself, but the Aligarh that he created. Or someone would say that his demands and his critique of the Congress in the late 19th century were stepping stones towards a communal idea, which later in the early 20th century, the communal award and these kind of things. At the same time, of course, he's seen as a progressive thinker by many modernist Muslims who consider his critique of, intervention of science in religion and rationality as something which is progressive. And at the same time, now we also have critiques of Sir Sayyed on the basis of caste and gender. I would think that it is very difficult to sort of pigeonhole someone like Sir Sayyed.
But what is the dominant idea in him? If you have to summarize, very difficult question.
I mean, it is a very subjective question, I would say.
Your personal reading, because you have just done... spent considerable time.
I would think that it is important for us to, I mean, as historians who are living in the contemporary world, to see what we sort of need from Sir Sayyed. So I think I can sort of also elaborate on the different sort of
stages and phases.
Okay. And then this one particular phase, which...
Okay, so what I am trying to do, we will hold this question, maybe that we will again...
At the end, maybe.
At the end, we will ask this question. So one way to proceed this discussion is to go chronologically.
Yes, I think...
Okay, so let me start with your MPhil work. I think you did your MPhil under Professor Valerian Rodriguez.
Yes, I did.
On the questions of Sir Sayyed Ahmad Khan and his idea of Tahzeeb. So what do you mean by... idea of Tahzeeb, and what is the gist of your MPhil work?
So, I mean, my MPhil work was basically focusing on the journal called Tehzeebul Akhlaq, which was founded by Sir Sayyid in Aligarh.
Achha, okay, friend, many people think that Sir Sayyid Ahmad Khan only wrote in English. I think he wrote a lot in Urdu.
Of course, he wrote a lot in Urdu and of course also in Farsi, in
also
Persian,
in Farsi also.
To begin
and
with.
And I know very little about Urdu literature, but one thing I can say, you will correct me, that he was great supporter of writing prose that is very much, what should I say, it is based on scientific ideas and it is not too much talking about emotions, but much more the language of day-to-day life.
Actually, Urdu literary scholars would point out that he's one of the foremost sort of person of Urdu prose.
Okay.
He made it very simple, he made it very accessible. So, Tehzeebul Akhlaq is a very good example of that. It was a journal that was started in 1876. It primarily was for students and it was basically 4 se 5 panno ka, it was a pamphlet kind of a thing, which had collected essays from Sir Sayyid and Hali and other Mohsin ul Mulk, other stalwarts of Aligarh. And they sort of, it was a summary or shorter editions of their larger complex philosophical historical treatises on Islam, on education of Muslims, on backwardness of Muslims and many of these themes. The journal was sort of inspired by many sort of thinkers and sort of many ideas. And Tehzeebul Akhlaq itself, which means refinement of morals, was taken from a text by Miskawi, who was this 10th and 11th century Islamic philosopher. Many of the ideas in the Tehzeebul Akhlaq were inspired by Nasiruddin Tusi. Okay. But also the journal's idea, Sir Sayyid was inspired particularly by the idea of coming out with a journal, was from Joseph Steele and Addison, who had this journal in England called Tatler and Spectator. Which basically the idea was that we made it accessible to common people. Common people as in the people at the university, not just big philosophers and historians. And it was in that way also a marker of a very simple Urdu prose, which then many Urdu prose writers took up. And this was much later in his career, in the 1870s, after the establishment of the Aligarh Muslim University. And this phase was basically, the phase that already preceded this was where he had written the tafsir, the exegesis of the Quran, which was basically trying to reconcile Western science with Quran. So aqayad, which is faith, with morals, which is akhlaq. And the refinement of morals meant that it was taking up a lot of Islamic morals from Nasiruddin Tusi, from Ibn Miskawi, and sort of trying to reconcile it with Western science and ideas. In the exegesis, for instance, a big thrust, which is not just, which is also later seen in Iqbal, is this reconciliation of revelation and reason. So the broad thrust was this. The Tehzeebul Akhlaq then sort of also had this idea of Tehzeeb, which means many different things, but the way Sir Sayyid often used was to become civilized. And of course, this was in the 19th century, now in retrospective, also it is a bit problematic in the sense that it is
disciplinary.
Firstly, it was a colonial discourse of civilizing the natives, the uncivilized. And Sir Sayyid took it up and said that we can be civilized if we have good morals. So good morals included being compassionate people, being many different things. Which he said had nothing to do with religion. Now, of course, this was part of the colonial discourse and Sir Sayyid could not escape it. But for me, what comes out of this is that he often said in this journal that, in several essays in this journal, that more than aqaid, the faith, actually good morals, if someone has good morals but may not have good faith, then it is fine. Instead, if someone has good faith but no morals.
Okay, so this is very important point. He is basically, Sir Syed Ahmad Khan is basically saying that your faith or your following a particular religion, that should not give you license that you are great and you are beyond criticism. Morality is also very important. And here comes the questions of humanity, that you go beyond narrow religious boundaries.
Yes.
So this is the good part of it. Yes, but you have also pointed out the criticism that the colonial discourse was so powerful that it has placed its own discourse, and Sir Syed Ahmad Khan was operating within that. So he was trying to struggle. He was trying to get good things from the Quran also. He was also talking about the morality also. Hmm. But reason and science, they were very dominant ideas. And I myself has done my MPhil on the idea of Muslim backwardness in 19th century. I also did some work on Sir Syed Ahmad Khan. Interestingly, Sohab, Nawab Abdul Latif was also the contemporary of Sir Syed Ahmad Khan. Hmm. And they were all talking about science, rationality, Syed Amir Ali. These all people were together, were contemporaries. And I found that a large number of Muslim intellectuals in the 19th century, they were struggling. They wanted to remain Muslims, but they were also getting criticism from outside that, okay, you have not progressed, you are backward. So this is your MPhil idea, MPhil. Okay, so when did you think of working on the idea of social hierarchy and contestations among Muslims in Amroha for your PhD work? What was the thing in your mind? How did you proceed from the Tahzibul Akhlaq to the questions of social stratification in colonial India?
Actually, it did sort of flow from reading Sir Syed to some extent. In the sense that this idea of akhlaq and morals that we talk in Sir Syed, when one starts to think as to who is he addressing to and what is actually the basis or the social class that Sir Syed comes from, then you realize that of course these morals and these things really mean basically it is all about the ashraf. Sir Syed, and this is of course a valid criticism, but there is a lot more to this. So for instance, in 1890s, just before he died, I think in 1893, he writes an autobiography called Seerat-e-Faridia, which is basically about his maternal grandfather, the experience of his maternal grandfather, Khwaja Fariduddin, who was a wazir in the Mughal court. And he had this aristocratic life. Of course, there was a lot of things about morals, how to treat poor people nicely, how to be compassionate and these kind of things. But there, what is revealed is this Ashraf milieu that Sir Syed comes from. And this is often, in his texts, of course, in Tehzeebul Akhlaq, for instance, there is a text called Tehzeeb, Kin Kin Cheezon Mein Tehzeeb Chahiye, in what things should we be civilized and how. So he says, of course, women's education is very important. He talks of human equality and these kind of things. But of course, when he goes to different places to mobilize different things and in speeches, this is what several critics of Sir Syed from the point of caste bring out, that he often had these views about the Razil or the Ajlaf or those who were not the Ashraf or who were not respectable, who. So, and that in that there are often, for instance, a small anecdote which many people quote is to do with, for instance, the IS examination, the civil service examinations in those times, which were conducted in London. And Sir Syed and the Congress was demanding that they are conducted in India. And Sir Syed made this argument against it, saying that in that sense, all these Razil classes and the social lower classes will be sort of, will come, and we cannot work under them. This is often quoted against him, fairly enough. But more than that, I think we have to understand the historical context. So in the sense that he is coming, a lot of his early writings, if we see, he is coming from, for instance, Islamic reformers from the 18th, 19th century, Shah Waliullah, or Sufi traditions like the Naqshbandi tradition, other Wahhabi intellectuals who Sir Sayyid was supporting till 1857, even beyond. And so it was not that he was never in the Islamic tradition or he was trying to betray Islamic tradition to become a Western rationalist. But actually, within that tradition as well, there was this idea that we have, that we need to go back to our sources, we need to go back to the Hadith and the Quran, and certain rasm, rivaj, customs, traditions are bidah or are innovation. So if that is the case, then to get back, to become respectable, civilized and all these things, then of course if you read these texts, you realize there must be someone who is uncivilized, there must be Muslims who are uncivilized, there must be Muslims who are practicing these rasmu rivaj which are coming from Hindus, which are sort of not part of the Islamic canon. And one thought that, of course, then where are those people? Sir Sayyid doesn't mention them, barring except a speech or two, which of course is criticizable. But then if you examine the larger question, which is to do with this Ashraf-Ajlaf distinction, you realize that this was prevalent among all sorts of writers, thinkers in the 19th century and even in the 20th century. So I got interested in this. I wanted to sort of look beyond the Ashraf and try and look for maybe voices that come from the non-Ashraf groups, for instance, Ansaris or Qureshis or groups which were being called Julahas or Kasabs. And fortunately, I did find this debate in Amroha, which was between Sayyids and the Qureshis, who were basically contesting each other's lineage, and they were sort of there. It was a polemical debate between these two groups.
Where were these debates printed, published?
So
what were the sources?
So there is basically in the 1930, from Amroha, there was a very major historian called Mahmud Ahmad Abbasi, who published 3 volumes of Tariq-e-Amroha. And it was a big 3-volume study, but it, one of the volume was Tehqeequl Ansab, which was researching the lineages and a study of Ilm al-Nasab, the lineages of different sects. And he basically elaborated in that distinctions of different kinds of Muslims, so Arabi, Ajmi, Hindi Nasl, based on their lineage. And said that certain Muslims were Sayyid, Sheikh, Mughal, Pathan, and then there were the Peshawar Akwam, which included Julahas, Kasabs, and these kind of groups. That was a very derogatory way of explaining Muslim society. And once, when he did that, there were sort of groups that were critiquing his work. So this particularly was done by, in Amroha, I'm talking, they happened all over across North India, in Bihar, in Bengal. But particularly this organization called the All India Jamiatul Quraysh, on which I work in my PhD. This was an organization of basically hide and leather and meat merchants who wrote replies. They did a lot of political mobilization as well, but they wrote replies to someone like Mahmud Ahmad Abbasi, who was a Sayyid and who was very proud of his Sayyid lineage. And they then sort of critique his narrative, and they also claim that we are also from the Quraysh tribe, we also have a good lineage. And they, in that critique, formulated an idea of masawat, which is equality. And they said that the basis of Islam is masawat rather than a pride of lineage or nasb or something like that. And they gave emphasis to their pesha or occupation. And they said that this is part of our identity. So they were sort of mobilizing this identity of the kasab, which was in Arabic, kas means to cut, and kasab was basically
kasab.
The butcher. But the Qureshi leaders of All India Jamiatul Quraysh wanted a broader idea of the Kasab, where they said that we are derived from that, but they, by the 20th century, were also leather merchants, and they had boot industries, shoe industries, And they also then said, we also have this kind of lineage, which you claim, which Ashraf claim. And I follow this debate closely. So there are several texts that were published by Qasab authors. And
so I don't have so much patience of a historian.
Yes.
But I'm asking you questions from political scientists.
Yes.
Now, so many leaders from lower caste background, the Muslims community, known as Pasmanda or Dalit Muslims, they take up the text of Sir Sayyid Ahmad Khan, Asbab-e-Baghawat-e-Hind, and they pick up one word, Bazzat-Jolaha. And basically, when the British Empire thought that the Ghadar was led by the Muslims, the revolt was led by the Muslims, Sir Sayyid Ahmad Khan wrote that pamphlet saying that no, Muslims were not against the British Empire. There were some people who opposed, and he himself did not approve of their activities. And then in passing, he made a reference of calling them as Bazzat Jolaha. So they just pick up, while the arguments given by those who may not uphold that idea, they said that they are reading too much out of this one word. So now, since you have done work, and you are a progressive thinker, so what do you think? How far that claim is correct? And how far? And another important thing, we should not try to read somebody out of the context also. For example, we cannot ask Plato to uphold the idea which we are upholding in 21st century. So how to maintain that balance?
Yes, I think I tend to agree with that, because it is not that there are others. I mean, the texts that I'm talking about, the critique of Sayyid Zain Ashraf, are 1930 and 1940. So one has to see things in context. And Sir Sayyid is writing Asbab-e-Baghawat-e-Hind right after 1857. Of course, once, the more you study him, the more you realize that he's confined within the Ashraf milieu, within the Zamidar milieu, within the Jagirdari milieu. And the Asbab-e-Baghawat-e-Hind is basically the voice of the Zamidar Muslim, the Jagirdar, who is saying that we need space.